Wanna know where is my tool bucket? Who took it from me? Broke into my house the night and stole from me. Using a blowtorch is quite insanity. Then got a rock and threw it through the window, the back door window. Snuck into the house, that foolish bucket full. Took it to the pawn shop to get money. Need your hands here now. Hey dude man, coolest thing around. Got my show now, you're my hands right now. This is Adam Sheffield. Welcome to American Heritage Center Radio, home of the Property Therapy and Talent Development Program.
We are Adam Sheffield and John Pine, the Property Therapists for America. And remember, if your property has problems or issues, it needs therapy. And in taking care of property, it takes care of you. We have here, live at the American Heritage Center, Jake Graber. He was an Amish man for over 50 years.
Yeah.
And now he's a German Baptist, which is analogous to the Mennonites.
Right.
And we have him on the show because the more the Amish people, he's going to tell us about some of the back behind the scenes of Amish life. And Amish people and the Mennonites are legendary for their property therapy skills. And the crazier this world gets, the crazier life gets, the less is more theology seems to have more appeal.
Starts looking pretty good.
And we have the many people think that the Amish is living without. And this is from an article in Time magazine that appeared a couple of years ago. And these devout communities predominantly located in Pennsylvania, Ohio, and Indiana, and then also up here in northern Missouri. We're live at the Heritage Center, and we're broadcasting from Independence, Missouri. And the Amish community is up north in Missouri. So they go without cars, TVs, computers, phones, or even the electricity needed to run so much of the 21st century gadgetry. But what researchers have studied them have found is what the Amish have a surplus of: good health in late life. And so they go without many things, but also they go without a lot of the diseases and health problems.
Oh, yes, that probably is quite true. They tend to take care of themselves, you know, good eating habits, tend to grow into working habits. If something's broke, you fix it. You don't stand around and dawdle. You grab a hammer or whatever you need to do and go to work, and you get it. Tend to keep life on an upbeat and moving forward. You're trying to move in like a forward direction. You're trying to get to where you can kind of relax. At the end of the day, you can take your shoes off and go to bed and sleep well, and tomorrow morning you'll be well rested. I think that probably has a lot to do with the longevity of a life. There's a lot of things that could probably be attributed to this.
They had in the life expectancy for the Amish back in the 1900s, for the average person in America, it was around 47 years old. But for the Amish people of that time, they were 70 years old, the average life expectancy. And we have now caught up to that life expectancy with modern healthcare with Amish. But however, the Amish still have a significant edge in late life health, with lower rates of cancer, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, and more. So yep. How do they do it?
Well, diabetes, being I've had to doctor about that myself. I have a type 2 diabetes. It is a matter of staying energetic, keep going. Your energy, your working, excessive work tends to run your sugar down.
For sure. To and that's levels. Property therapy. When you're taking care of property, you're it right. takes care of you, doesn't it?
Right, it does. It just reverses and comes right back to your own your own gains, be it however it is, be it in the longevity of your life or however you want to deal with it.
In 2004, the American College of Sports Medicine fitted Amish volunteers with pedometers to determine how much physical activity they performed. The results were dramatic. Amish men took 18,425 steps a day and women 14,196 steps, compared with non-Amish people who are encouraged by doctors to shoot for at least 10,000 steps and typically fail, including other forms of manual labor, lifting, chopping, sowing, planting. The Amish are six times as active as a random sample of people from 12 other countries.
That is kind of amazing data, but it probably is true. The Amish, like everything else, society pushes you to where the recliner gets a little bit in the way, and it probably is tend to drop in a little bit. But I myself, Tim, when you get home and you're tired and you get down on the recliner, you're kind of hard to move. However, if you see something that needs to be done, you just get, it's just like a natural habit. You get up and you go do it, and you need to fix up this. The lawnmower's broke, the washing machine broke, whatever it may be. You use your own ingenuity and try to get it going.
So according to Time Magazine, 4% of Amish people are obese, compared with 36.5% of the overall U.S. population.
That probably is very true, and that gives to good eating habits. If you're going to overeat, they got some awful good bakers in the Amish community that probably tend to help make obese, but there's a lot of other things. They got a lot more energies in other things. Going back to, like you said, your commercial, your property, be it whatever it is, there's always something to do outside, whether it's mow the grass or whether you're going to fix the window that was broke last year or whatever. You got something to do.
You know, and this is something what we're talking about, what we talk about on the show, if you can't take care of your body property, how can you take care of all sorts of other property? And there's lots of unforced errors that we do in modern society, all these things that we put in our bodies, addictive substances and whatnot, that just... But in the Amish community, the near absence of tobacco in the Amish community, some men do smoke cigars, but it results in a 63% lower rate of tobacco-related cancers, according to a 2004 study of Ohio's Amish population. And the Amish also had the rates of all cancers that were 40% lower than the rest of the population.
That's probably true. They're subject to getting cancer, like you said, but some of them have been known to use tobacco and stuff, but... the Amish, as they became more and more evident that smoking was bad for your lungs and this kind of thing, the Amish church made quite a few steps in trying to get rid of all tobaccos instead of allotting like moderate use. Or some churches were not kind of open to smoking. Back in the day, and then they tell me this, the grandmas in church would bring their pipes to smoke and sat there before church services started, and they would smoke the pipe. And I'm like, what? Grandma smoking a pipe? That just was kind of unheard of, but I guess it did happen. Back in their day, they used to do things quite a lot different than what it is today, but that's how they...
We have here Jake, and he has been an Amish man for over 50 years.
Probably closer to 60.
Near 60 years. And he took the Amish beard challenge, didn't he?
Yeah. He's got us all beat.
Yeah, so we measured the length of his phenomenal beard in it, and it reached 8 inches. And that was from the top of the beard to the bottom there is right there. And it doesn't count the little goatee or the patch. He doesn't have a patch. So that's we don't count that as part of the beard because it's not connected and it's not there.
Actually, when I did let my beard grow up, which is actually the original order, they're supposed to grow to the bottom of your lip, it would grow straight out and it would tend to get in your food when you were eating. And that's one of the reasons why I tend to kind of shave it back so I could eat properly without having
There's logistical concerns, isn't there?
Yeah.
Yeah, so we'll put out the Amish Beard Challenge. So if any Amish men want to come to the American Heritage Center and see if they can outdo the length of the beard of Jake's beard, we'll get a prize for him. So Jake is so you when you were in the Amish community, you got divorced, and so you couldn't fully be part of the community after that.
Well,
correct?
We actually are still legally married. We're just separated. That was her choice. She wanted to do it that way, so we separated mutually and still separated today. There's been some effort that some of the children do want us to get together again, which probably might happen. I don't know. I'm leaving the door open to whatever is down the road. We'll have to see how it works out.
So Jake, we have Jake here, and it's extraordinary to have Jake on the on the radio with us. And the people in the Amish community, it's difficult, wouldn't you say, for them to open up and talk on the radio about the
when they get into things like that. It's just from being trained all your life. You're being trained. You're rigged against radio and television and stuff. And then all at once, you're up here, you're talking on the radio. And, oh, my, you know, it tends to over-glorify that or to overshoot it somehow. So
theologically, where it comes from, let's talk about that in the scriptures, where in the Bible you were talking about the scripture, be not conformed to the world.
Right. Be not conformed to the world. Stay back from the world and be your own thing.
Be a separate people.
Be separate people.
It's in the New Testament and
yes, it is. I think it's in Matthew that you can actually read that. I might be corrected on that, but it does have a lot to, well, with your church uniform you put on and stuff, if somebody sees you going down the road, well, that guy's Amish. They can tell by the clothes or the suit he's wearing.
So the Amish community gives a very broad interpretation to that scripture.
Yes,
and every church has different interpretations and broad definition, narrow definitions, and it's why we have so many different churches,
right, in the world,
in the Christian diaspora, there's thousands and thousands and thousands of different churches because there's so many different interpretations of the scriptures, and it's why Christianity functions so well in democratic societies because it allows people to think differently and have different interpretations versus there's other faith orientations like Islam where there's not thousands and thousands of different interpretations, are there? And there's very much an effort to keep things, people thinking alike, see? And it has an intimidation element, terroristic intimidation element to it. So it makes it more difficult for them to settle themselves in a democratic society that allows, and that's why some religious faiths where there's thousands and thousands of different interpretations of the Bible, and the faith allows for that.
Well,
you know? For instance, like Jesus, I haven't seen Jesus come on the radio lately and say, this is the way that I want it.
Right.
He hasn't come on Fox News or CNN lately.
That's probably all Jeff's fault, but
He'll come. He'll be there soon.
it does have a lot of that, you know, like you're going on and you think, well, this is the way it is. But the church has been, over all the years, trying to stay confronted in a oneness, everybody thinking alike and stuff. But I think it was General Patton that said, if everybody thinks alike, nobody's thinking. And that this is a little bit how that works.
Right.
And this is why, when you have an outspoken one come out and speak out against somewhat of the order of the church, he becomes kind of like a black sheep or a rough, and then they tend to kind of,
So the Amish community give a very broad interpretation to the be not conformed to the world, in more than just in a moral sense, like a conduct sense, but and also a technological sense.
Yes, yes.
Be not conformed to the world and not take the devil's instruments, the devil's technology.
Well, that's what it is. But there's so many things. I've heard a telephone referred to as a devil's instrument. I said, well, now, you're speaking on the phone. If it's a devil's instrument, I wouldn't even call nobody. I'd put the phone down and forget
it. So what is it life without AC?
Actually, it's sometimes pretty hot. No, it does. AC, if you grow up and you're not used to television, I've had people come up, did you see so-and-so on TV? No, I didn't. But how do you do without TV? If you don't have it, you don't know what you're missing. It's the same way with AC. You open the windows, you stay as cool as you can, you do the best you can, and live with what you got. And most of them are happier living that way than they are they're most happier, you know, living in a contented, peaceful world, which is more stress-free.
So do you think you could live without electricity?
Well, yeah, it'd probably be a little harder, but I've lived that way for so long that I could probably go back to that without a real big issue. I'm sure it'd be troublesome somewhat, but I could, yes.
So you drive a car, is that correct?
Yes, yes, I do.
So now that was after, because in the Amish community, the divorce is not tolerated.
Yeah.
And the your wife decided that she didn't want a husband.
Yeah.
That was like 8 years ago.
Yeah.
So the Mennonites are a little more liberal with technology than the Amish, and the German Baptists are analogous to the Mennonites.
See, right? We have like telephones, we have electricity, we have AC and all them little things that, tend to make life a lot more comfortable. A lot of them have started using fans. They've got the air oscillating fans and stuff and move air around, which tends to make life a little more pleasant. And then there's some of them that wouldn't allow fans. And it goes back to the interpretations of the order of the church. What do we allow and what don't we allow?
I remember reading, for those that have been listening to this radio program, last week we had the Latino Tribute show and was reading lots of books, Hispanic books about Hispanic culture, True Tales of Mexican Migration, books like this. And in one of the books, in the migration books, I read about a German Baptists that were in Mexico that got caught as in a drug smuggling ring in Canada, and they traced it back, and they were interviewing, well, what happened? Where did this get wrong? Where did this go awry? And they said, and the the preachers they were talking about, it all started when they put rubber on the tractor tires.
That would be probably a logical response. There was at one time, and going back to that, it's interesting you bring that up, that there was quite a colony of them down not too far from Mexico City. They lived out in the desert, but there was a pretty big group of them. They lived more like a commune, like the Hutterites. Everybody worked together, and they just lived out of the one pot. That must have been from the same bunch. I'm not really sure, just too much. I do remember even today hearing stories about the communication. You know, they would go down there to try to help the church along. They might ordain some of them to the ministry and things like that. And pretty soon this minister that they ordained and thought was a man of God might have been fornicating with somebody else's wife, and it became quite problematic. So they, I don't know, I think that kind of broke the ties with a lot of that, and they must have moved. That might have been more the problem than the rubber tires.
Yeah, so the tractor tires were embedded with steel bands. Yes. Right. And so they were very jolty when they were driving on the tractors.
Yeah.
And so they decided, well, we'll try putting rubber on the tires. And it was like the camel pushing the camel's nose in the tent. And it just ended up where it happened.
Yeah, that would sound pretty much. They had a lot of issues. And like any other church, you have growing pains. You have to keep working and try to work in one common goal direction and in a big united, to try to unite that many minds to work in a oneness, to get together. Let's say we're going to build a church house, and you got to get everybody to say, yes, we want a church house. Now, how big do we want the church house, and what color do we want? You can become, that can become quite, there'll be somebody invariably that's going to disagree with you. So
like the story about what they did to the man's buggy, it reminds me of that. They had some disagreement what was going on there at the schoolhouse. What was going on there?
Well, that happened many years ago. A matter of fact, I don't think I was even with the youth at that time. I must have been younger than that. But they went down and got old Joe Sports's open buggy and brought it up and put it on top of the Jamesport two-story. They put it up there, and poor old Joe had a hard time understanding why they put the buggy up there and how they got it up there and how we're going to get it down.
This is the horse-drawn buggy that you see the Amish driving on the sides of the road. So they lifted that up with a lot of effort and put it on the top of to be the new mascot for the school, huh? The Amish buggy.
It was actually Amish kids, and there was quite a few of the other kids, which they kind of went to school together there for a while until they broke in the parochial schools and started that. That's when the segregation actually started between the Amish kids and the others. Otherwise, they went to school together for most part, and it tended to draw them to.
So you have us top, because I remember as kids playing pranks and grabbing shoes and throwing them on roofs. We never put any Amish buggies on roofs.
Oh, there'd be probably quite a few, you know, going out and taking the outhouse and moving it up on the square at Jamesport and leaving it there. You could go on with them stories, and I'm pretty sure you could fill up quite a book.
And it reminds me of the buggies of the, you know, those triangles, the fluorescent triangles they've got on the back of the buggies. Mm-hmm. And I heard about that some of the Amish didn't want to put that in the back. Yes. What was the reason for
that? Well, that goes right back to they were saying, oh, that orange color, that's the color of the devil and stuff. Well, it is, but that's why you put orange on, and these same Amish.
And the triangle was, what was that, a pentagramic, or what was, that?
It was there for your own safety and for your own, if your headlights flash on, it reflected, and it indicated there's a buggy there, or a slow-moving emblem, that's what it's really. And, you know, to go deer hunting, they require you to put a fluorescent orange on. And there were some of them over there, they didn't want to wear orange. And I was talking to the assessor one day, and she said, Jake, will you help Steve Hudson here? He don't know what to do with them. I said, well, the way I look at it, you wear hunter's orange to protect you, and the other guy that's shooting, he don't want to shoot you either. You wear it for safety. If you're not going to wear it, then don't go hunting, I guess. That's about as close as I can tell what to do with it. But
so they said that they came up with a compromise. Instead of the triangle, they put a square.
is there a reason why the buggies are always black? I mean, because the other alternative is to paint the buggy orange.
Well, that would be. I don't know where the black is. Now, I was recently to Pennsylvania, and they have gray buggies. They actually, their buggies are a lot more modern than ours. They had air shocks on their buggies. They span two or three times what we do for a buggy. But they had air shocks on it. It turn signals. It was just awesome. I went, what's going on here? But that's another case of modernism moving into the church, and it'll be whatever. Yeah, although all of them got their good reasons. A turn signal's obviously why you use a turn signals to indicate to the guy behind you that you are turning left or right, whatever the case might be. It whatever you, there'd be a lot of ways to go with that.
And so they didn't. They came up with the square on the back of the buggy, and they said, I don't want to put it on there either.
Most of them were worried about the color. That's the way I understood it. But yeah, the color is put out, stands out. It's flashy. Yes, it is. It is very flashy, but it's done there for safety. It's done for to protect you and your family or whoever else may be in the buggy with you, so that somebody don't just pop up and run into you and not just kill you and everybody in the buggy, but the horse and everything else.
So in Amish are very, they stick together very closely. So how does society affect your life?
Well, it's got quite a few ways of affecting us. Let's just say the children, the youth, they're going, and they tend to run around and they meet the other kids that's driving a vehicle, or they may be smoking a cigarette or things like that. And they tend to pick up them habits and bring them into your own house. And you're trying to avoid them habits. You don't want them habits coming into your house. You don't want the boy to do it, but then he becomes somewhat addicted to cigarettes or be it whatever it may be. You have to help him work through that and try to get it, overcome the problem.
How does COVID-19 affect your community, or how's it been, well, affecting your community?
It obviously shut things down. People want to go to work, and you know, most of your Amish people, as well as anybody else, go to, they go outside, they want to, well, they're going to go to work. They're going to go get the horses hooked up and go haul manure, if nothing else. they don't want a mask on their face when they're hauling manure because they need all the breath they can get to get it loaded up. And just things like that, that, yeah, most of them, I think, would, out of respect, out of people at the grocery store or whoever asks you to wear a face mask, I think they will, but it was, where the issue comes is if you're just there at the house, you and the wife and the kids, you tend to think, well, we don't need a face mask or we don't need this and that. That in ways like this.
I haven't seen too many pictures of Amish people with the face masks.
I doubt if you will either, to be my guess, but I...
It's a somewhat, the thought of it is somewhat anachronistic. You know, yeah. That's what, like, blending things that don't seem to go together.
You're wanting to change things, and to change a habit that's been ingrained into you all your life, that can become pretty hard to do.
The blending, and speaking of the blending of worlds, technologically, I've seen the Amish, pictures of the Amish when they have harvesters in the fields, but they're being pulled by horses.
Right. That is, anymore, it is becoming more and more. When Grandpa and them grew up, they could have a 40-acre farm and a few old hogs and stuff and raise a family. Not only pay for the farm, but they could pay for and make a living. Them days have done and gone. You know,
the global economy.
Yeah, global economy. You have to farm 200 acres, and to get over 200 acres with horses, you're going to either kill horses or something. You've got to suffice and use every direction you can.
You know, it reminds me of the scripture where Jesus says, if you've got the ox in the mire,
right.
You know, then you know, the scribes and the Pharisees says, you can't be using that.
Right.
You know, you can't be using that because it's on the Sabbath. And Jesus said, well, doesn't a man pull his ox out of the mire on the Sabbath? Doesn't he do that on the Sabbath? Right.
Right.
And so it's all about gaining wisdom. Right.
Right.
In this life to understand. It's like if you wanted to destroy yourself, there's lots of ways to do it.
Right.
Or if you want to protect yourself, there's ways where you can keep your integrity, but at the same time be realistic.
Right.
And so, but that's all what this life's all about, is gaining wisdom.
It's called common sense.
And for some people, you got to, they would maybe need to have a little more of this in their life. And then maybe later on in life, not so much. Who knows? It's how their the character development aspect of people's existence is in their faith orientation.
That's probably does a very well job, a real good job of describing what you're trying to put out there. Try to put things like that in word, or try to explain to somebody what the difference is between this group and that group. That can be somewhat frustrating because a lot of people don't understand. They grew up in a society where they had AC, they had all that, and to say there's one guy, one church will allow you to use a lawnmower, just the old real type lawnmower where you push and push and push. And then some of the lawnmowers have motors on top, and then you become, that's how society affects. Some are starting to use even riding lawnmowers, and the zero turn, it keeps going on.
So we are here with Jake Graber, and he was an Amish man for nearly 60 years. And I gave tours in northern Missouri of the Amish community and the Mennonite community.
Yep, there would sometimes a bus tour would come by, and they would ask you to get up and tell them about it. It was just your basic trying to tell them, some of them tourists that got on the bus probably know about as much about the Amish as some of the tour leaders they had, and they became kind of somewhat challenged or with that, and they wanted somebody that really knowed or understood that, because by the questions I was asked, I could tell that they were knowledgeable about the group.
Now, some of the this is the Property Therapy radio show, and we've chronicled a lot of the powerful benefits that the property therapy engaged in taking care of properties. It helps take care of you. And we've talked about the physical aspects of it, helps you get health-wise. And then last show we were talking about, and in other shows we were talking about the spiritual aspect of it, where it helps you develop and get promptings while you're working with your hands.
Right.
You get closer to God, do you feel that way?
Oh, yes, I think that really has a lot to do. See, if you go out and you labor with your bare hands, it goes back to what we've talked about earlier. You go to bed, you're ready to sleep, you wake up, you're well-rested, and et cetera. But on the other hand, it also tends to get you more alert. Your mind is sharper. It just helps you all the way around. You feel better about yourself if you come home to a well-kempt home instead of one that's cluttered up and you got all kinds of cars and stuff in the yard on blocks and you haven't got them fixed up or whatever it might be. So you're looking at a matter of pride and respect as far as trying to, yes, and spiritually it's got to make you feel like, say, cleansiness is next to godliness, so you tend to think of clean being kind of an ultimate way of getting things done.
Let me ask you this question. Is for those that want the Amish experience, would that be possible to, like, live in an Amish community, among an Amish community, for like a few weeks or a month or something? Or is that not something that's allowed?
No, it that has happened in the past. I do know there's some LDS folks up by Jameson that attend our church quite regularly. They're good friends of mine. I think they've had their issues with the church and were maybe excommunicated, but they're very interesting folks, ask a lot of questions.
As far as living in the community, though, getting up at the crack of dawn, this be possible?
Oh, yeah. If you want to get up and you want to put the energy in it, it'll take a lot on you.
So they would allow that?
Would probably allow that. It would take,
like living on the farm and...
Well, if you say you wanted to get up... Now, what separates a lot is they use a German language or the Pennsylvania Dutch. And they'll converse to each other in Pennsylvania Dutch. You have a language barrier. You have a few things that you would have to kind of overcome or compensate for if you were going to do something like that.
So we are here with Jake, Jake Graber, and he is, we are live at the American Heritage Center, and he is, it's been great having you with us. Jake has his long, magnificent Amish beard that we measured, and he's taken the Amish beard challenge. Eight inches is the length of his beard. And he has had to take off his Amish hat in order to get the headphones on. We have our hearing headphones on. And so it's been great having you with us. People's faith orientation in their lives here, it's one of the beautiful things that we have in America and in the Christian diaspora, the vast diversity of the ways. There's so many ways, different ways of interpreting the Bible and whatnot. As long as that Jesus Christ is in the mix, in the atonement capacity, because the world's a messed up place, you know? All of us have problems and issues, and the more that we do property therapy in our lives, and, you know, it helps bring out the best in us and helps us just like run forward to the bright horizon.
Right. That's quite truthful. It's bringing your you out and putting you on the top, and you're running your life, trying to stress free as you can. You're trying to get through life, and you want to go on to your internal reward as peaceful as you can.
Yeah, we have now here at the Heritage Center. So it's property therapy, and we've chronicled that with people's faith orientations, because it helps them. If we've noticed that at the Heritage Center, if people have a faith orientation in their life, they have a more purpose-driven existence. And then if they have that, they take better care of property. So we've chronicled and talked with a lot of different faith orientations of people that have that, and to understand where they come from. And then we even have the faith orientation theme song from the lockdown suite that I wrote a suite of songs under quarantine. I call it the lockdown suite, and one of the songs is the faith orientation song. And so, but it's property therapy, not only property for its own sake, but to be able to realize and develop your talents and dreams. So we're going to play some guitar, or we're going to play some some songs and call it out on the radio for the chords. So for those that are tuning in and listening to us, get your guitars out, and we're going to play some songs and then call out the chords so you can play along with the radio. This is the first time in American history, you think, John?
Big strum-a-long.
Yeah, we're strum-a-long for our radio audience. So we're really bringing back the golden age of radio.
Hey man, I just came up with a great business idea. Just listen to you guys talk. Let's buy some property outside the city, hire us some Amish guys, and we're going to start an Amish resort.
Nice.
Where we have
the Amish experience.
These guys teach our first guests how to have a good barn raising and a house or in the church and all that stuff. And once we start building that, and then the guests they're booked for the next week, get to come in and build upon that. And pretty soon we'll have our own little Amish resort community where we have some Amish people come work and show how it's done back at their place. We'll have to
help people overcome their worldly PTSD.
Yeah. Well, get a good night's sleep.
Exactly.
Get away from the technology. We'll have to block all the cell signals.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, that's true. You get into tools, like you said, some of them would be avoided power tools, and some of them can care less. Some of them would use a chainsaw to cut the log in half, and, it varies quite a lot, Well, the old wooden frame barns that were pinned together and stuff, those were 8-10 inches square. Cutting them with a handsaw or one of them old crosscut saws, that was a slow death trying to cut them off.
You get a good night's sleep out of it.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah, no, and it reminds me of the Ed Lead Scallion.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Cutting the coral rock.
The coral rock. We talked about him in the...
Yeah.
He built a little miniature castle he lived in out of coral stone that he pulled out of the ground there in Homestead, Florida.
He built it all by himself.
Yeah, you can
cut it out by himself.
Coralcastle.com if you want to see his story, or just look up Ed Lead Scallion on Wikipedia. Or the internet, just do your search. You'll see what we're talking about. Lots of videos on YouTube of that.
And he pulled out these rocks out of the ground that are like 6-ton rocks, 10-ton rocks.
Yep.
And then he pulled them out by himself with the winch and the and he used tripods
and chains.
Tripod after tripod. And then like he built a mini tripod, then a big tripod, then a big tripod. And some of the tripods are like 20-foot-tall tripods.
He got some bearings from old Fords in the junkyard and made some gates where the rock would swivel.
And he balanced it perfectly.
And open up a gate in the wall because it'd be like that and then turn. And then it'd be balanced so well that a little kid could just push on it and it would rotate.
And he'd be working on his rock park at night. And he did it for 20
years. Yeah, also made
years.
His living.
Just did it himself.
Made his living giving the tours.
Mm-hmm.
That's so interesting.
He had that same mentality, property therapy.
Property therapy. He was the...
He lived it as,
It works. Property therapy works.
And this is our property therapy bird.
Hey, how's it going? We have our property therapy bird.
The Bower Bird.
The Bower Bird. Hey, how's it going, Bower Bird? Hey, how's it going?
And the Bower Bird, we featured the Bower Bird. Why we call the Bower Bird the property therapy bird is that they are known to be property therapies. They build their own bachelor pads on the ground.
Yeah.
And they get these tools, like they'll get these little sponges somehow and then dab them in berry juice and color the bower of their nest. They color it with berry juice according to what they're doing. And then they watch, the bower bird watches the older bower birds. And they learn construction, and each year their bower gets bigger and more ornate and impressive from watching and learning from the other bower birds.
Well, that's interesting, but that's how it's taught on.
Yeah, no, they watch the bower. So that's why the bower birds, the official mascot of the American Heritage Center, and that's, we got our bower bird here. So we got the puppets. We got the bower bird here, and then we've got some other puppets on the show. We'll
have to feature those in a future video when we start making some parodies.
Yeah, and the bower bird also takes straws. It creates a color-coordinated nest on whatever it's trying to build, and it'll grab, like, purple. If that's the theme, it'll take purple straws and purple bottle caps, purple this, purple that, and it'll go around and snatching stuff like a crow, and then it puts it all around the bower to attract the ladies to come.
Oh, yeah.
It's mate. Yeah, it's incredible. It's ornate. It's the property therapy bird.
No kidding. That would be, you'd have to go into the fluorescent colors to get them, or lime green or whatever, to get attract them. That seems to be the going thing for today's crowd, is something that's rather flashy or stands out. I don't know.
It's extraordinary that a bird can do that. So let's do some property therapy, some sound property therapy now.
Yeah, let's make our way over to the stage and get our instruments out.
It's been great having you with us, Jake.
Hey, thank you. And I've enjoyed it, and we'll see you guys later.
Welcome to the Property Therapy and Talent Development Radio Show. This is property not for its own sake, but to be able to realize your talents and dreams. And part of that, we have in the logo, it's the judicial hammer, which signifies the property therapy and where it can get you in life, and also the violin, and that, so the musical aspect of the show. And we're having a play along here, so get your guitars out. And I'm going to call the chords to the Unchained Melody. And we're canceling the cancel culture. We're bringing back the golden age pop and rock songs from American history. We're bringing them back. So get your guitars out. I'm going to call out the chords, and you can play along with our radio show here. This will be the first time in American history where you get to play along with us on the radio. But here's Unchained Melody. And here we go. I'm going to play it once. I'm going to call out the chords the first time, and then I'm going to sing it the next time. G, E minor, C, D, G, E minor, D, D7, G, E minor, C major, D, G, E minor, B minor. Now D, G, D, E minor, G, A minor, D, G. Now C major, D major, C major, B flat, C major, D, G. Now C major, D, C major, B flat, C, D, G.
Oh, my love, my darling, I've hungered for your touch a long, lonely time. Time goes by so slowly, and time can do so much. Are you still mine? I need your love. I need your love. Godspeed your love to me. Lonely river, flow to the sea, to the sea.
Okay, now, if you're ready to get your Amish community started building, we have some real estate lots for sale on Lake Tarzany, which is just east of Jackson County, and beautiful lakefront lots. And you can build a dock on one of them and plenty of boat access. They're beautiful lots. They're listed at $16,000 for two of the lots and then $10,000 for the other two lots. And call me at 816-674-3035 to get your lots, to build your start building your Amish community, or to realize your dreams in all sorts of ways. Get your property harbor going on so you can realize your talents and dreams. Call me again at 816-674-3035, and we'll get you some beautiful lots on the Lake Tarzany. So again, call me at 816-674-3035. And also call this number to get your FTS rings. We just have 250 of them now in stock at the Heritage Center. Size 7, size 8, 9, size 10, size 11, size 12. And so we can get you fitted up with your FTS rings. They're $40 per ring. And call 816-674-3035. FTS is follow the spirit. Follow the spirit of God. You got to follow FTS to know what is right in your life and how to move forward to the bright horizon in your life. This is Adam Sheffield with American Heritage Center Radio Live with the Property Therapy Show. We dedicate this song to the Black Lives Matter protesters. Racism is going down like the Titanic. Whether it's objective or subjective racism, it's going down. All lives don't matter until Black Lives Matter. And Black Lives Matter with Property Therapy. Because the Black community has been used by the Democrat Party, who's wanted the race issue without really helping them.